Glory to the Lamb. Vital, important information today. Vital. Are you ready?
Amen.
Good. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 3. Let's speak it. I thank God whom I serve with a pure conscience, as my forefathers did, as without ceasing I remember you in my prayers night and day, greatly desiring to see you, being what?
Mindful
of your tears, that I may be filled with joy. When I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is what? In you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded is in you also. Therefore, I what? Remind you to stir up the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. In other words, I remind you to stir up the Holy Spirit. I remind you. Everyone say, remind.
Remind.
Everyone say, remind.
Remind.
Brings refresh.
Refresh.
Therefore, for God has what? Not given us a spirit of fear, but power and love and a sound mind. Remind means what? Refresh. In other words, bring to remembrance, practice, make consistent. Because when you're reminded of things, you consist. It brings a practice, doesn't it? So he says, I remind you. In other words, come back. Keep coming back until it's perfected in you. And what are we stirring up? The Holy Spirit. Why? Because the Holy Spirit with power, love, and sound mind. Because the spirit of fear is led by deception. The spirit of fear is always led by the spirit of deception. Deception always goes first and fear follows. Is everybody with me? See, because the enemy wants to deceive you and then bind you with fear. That's his job. So the spirit of deception will go before the spirit of fear. And the spirit of fear wants to disconnect us from power, love, and sound mind. From what? Power, love, and sound mind. Of who? The Holy Spirit. Does everybody get this? It is vital. Why? Because, remember, the world is run by Satan's kingdom. His major weapons are deception, and his power is fear. He uses those things. To what? Try and disconnect us. Remember, fear protects pride. Pride protects selfishness or self, the offspring of darkness. So what does the enemy want to do? He wants to bring individuals into bondage. And he wants to control the new man through the old man. He wants to control the new man through the old man. Has everybody got it? What? Then people become children of the devil. Does everybody got that? Remember, your old man is an offspring of darkness. So you don't want to be controlled by Satan's deception. You don't want to be controlled by his fear. And what it does is, again, when fear comes, it disconnects me and you from the love, power, and sound mind of the Holy Spirit. And that's why many people, one of the things the enemy wants to do is breach you from God's love. Because when things don't go people's ways, they always say, well, why did God allow this to happen? What the enemy's always trying to do is breach God's love. God's love for you and me never ceases. His love stays the same no matter what you've done. He's always for us. The problem is most people, see, fear, I want you to grab hold of this. Fear will interrupt God's plan. So what happens then, a person, when fear comes, it tries to move that person so they don't give God an opportunity to work.
Amen.
Has everybody got it? They don't do what? They don't give God the opportunity to what?
Work.
work in their life. So what happens is, how many of y'all know anxiousness is fear? Be anxious for nothing. Be anxious for nothing. Why? Because anxiousness is pushed by fear, which gets you to move in the flesh. You will interrupt the plan of God by trying to do it yourself. Is everybody okay? That's why many people move from one thing to another. Nothing goes, they get offended very easily. They quit jobs or move from one job to another. They move from ministry to ministry to ministry. Why? Because fear is actually ruling them. Is everybody okay? 1 John chapter 4. So you're either going to get refreshed or refleshed. Has everybody got it? That's today's teaching, refresh or reflesh. Yes. Refresh or reflesh. Boy, you know when someone's been refleshed. And you know when someone's been refreshed. So bringing things to remembrance is an area of God saying, refresh yourself. Bring to remembrance, refresh yourself. Why? One of the things, that's why it says they overcame by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their what? Testimony. Look at you. You hear testimonies. It's refreshing. Yeah, man, God can do it for you. He can do it for me. And then God's just building the testimony in your life. So you're going to remember the things that God has done for you and bring them into the present. And that's going to set your future. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. In this love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. How many of y'all love us also? Look at. There's a place of love where there's trust. Now, there's a level of love and there's a level of trust. You can love someone, but you don't trust them. Amen? Amen? But then there's a place where you not only love them, but you trust them. And that's where God wants to get us to where he not only, because his love for me and you is constant, but his trust is earned. His trust is earned. So never think that just because he loves us, he trusts us. He loves us constantly. That doesn't change. But his trust towards us can change. Amen? Amen. All right, let's go a little further here. Glory to God. Where are we at? All right. Okay. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us. Say it again. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. Verse 13. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent the Son as Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God and God in him. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have the boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. In other words, his love. When you're abiding in him and you're abiding in his love, there is an identity that's established. Identity is brought by the presence of God, because God's presence is love. Verse 18. Let's speak this together. There is no fear in love. Say it again. There is no fear in love. Say it again. There is no fear in love. But perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves what? Torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. If someone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he's a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? So perfect love casts out fear. Say it with me. Perfect love casts out fear. So he says, he who abides, in other words, when you abide in his word, when you abide in his presence, when you abide in fellowship, it brings a refreshing. That's why the word says, forsake not to assemble. It's that simple. Brings perfect love, which overcomes fear. What's God's love? Peace, joy, and righteousness in the Holy Spirit. That's his love. But again, the powers of darkness, fear, will bring insecurity, will bring anxiety, will bring stress. It even brings oppression. What does it do? It causes a breach of God's love, power, and a sound mind. What it does then, it brings us into the flesh and away from the spirit. It causes us a disconnect from God's love. Us to be disconnected, not him to be disconnected. Has everybody got it? He's never disconnected from us. We get disconnected from him. 1 Corinthians 13. So what we're gathering here right now, we just praised, we worshiped. We're being refreshed in God's word. So there's a refreshing coming. Why? Because it's bringing remembrance. It's reminding us. So we got to constantly remind us. We got to constantly refresh us in God's love. Why? Because his perfect love casts out what? All fear. All fear. 1 Corinthians 13. Now, you know, again, the enemy knows how to set us up. He knows to set us up to get us offended. He knows to set us up to get rejected. He knows how to set us up. Did you ever ask God for something and you already knew the answer was no, but you're trying to sway him? Amen. And then when he doesn't answer us, or he rejects us, or he doesn't really reject us, he just doesn't say anything. Oh, God, why have you done this? Then you feel rejected. See, when this love comes and this perfect love comes, you're not making decisions by how you feel no more. You're making decisions by truth, because you've cast off fear. Because fear always promotes an emotional state of being, where people live out of the soul instead of out of the spirit. Fear wants to trap you in the soulish arena, because it knows that he can sway you easy by how you feel. He knows he can cause you to make wrong decisions and be misled in how you feel. And then people make emotional decisions instead of decisions by truth. And then they still carry those burdens. You know, unforgiveness is nothing but fear. Bitterness is associated with fear. All of these things are associated with fear. Fear is the prime category that brings people into bondage. Fear. Fear of success, fear of not having enough, fear of going before a judge, fear of not pleasing, fear. All of these areas of fear, fear. But perfect love casts out all fear. Amen. All fear. What can man do to you if God's with you? Amen. See, but you need to speak it so you eat it. Because what you eat is what you become. See, but the devil, you cannot overcome the devil in your thoughts. He'll kick your butt. You overcome him by speaking the word, by praising God and blessing him. Why? Because you're being refreshed. Things are coming to remembrance. It's amazing. Let me tell you, you get attacked right after God does something. That's his job. That's the devil's job. Why? Because he's trying to steal That not only the blessing, but that remembrance. Why? Because he's trying to breach love. That's the devil's prime objective, is to breach the love of God in your life so you are bound by fear. Oh, glory. Is everybody okay? 1 Corinthians 13 and verse 4. Now, love, grab hold of this. Love is not a feeling. It's a choice. God loved us, and now we choose to love him. Now, love will build an emotion. It builds a connection because you love. Love is an area where you feel secure. It's a place where you feel safe. There is no torment at all in love. Now, there's the love of the world, which actually is called lust. It's not the love of God. It's different. That lust will bring bondage. That lust will bring torment. That lust will bring fear. That's why relationships have a hard time, because there's mistrust, there's jealousy. Why? It's all that's fear, because it's not the love of God. It's the love of the world. It's called lust. Oh, hallelujah. Then people have a lustafarians. Instead of a love affair, it's a lust affair. Amen. Verse 4, are you ready? What is this love of God? Love of God what? Suffers long. When you look at, you're willing to suffer through. Why? Because you're denying yourself. You're not first anymore. Love suffers long. It is what? Kind. It's not an idiot. Love does not envy or become jealous. Love does not parade itself or prideful or arrogant. Is not puffed up. Does not behave rudely. Does not seek its own. Oh, my gosh. Is not provoked. Hallelujah. Thinks no evil. Well, we all been just disconnected. But you overcome it when evil comes. Sometimes you want to think that dirty rat. But you overcome it. Verse 6. Does not rejoice in iniquity. You don't go up to someone and say, I told you so. Look at you. You already know it. You don't got to tell them. God already knows. Does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices what? In truth, because when you love, when you're in love with God's love, you love truth. And your decisions are made by truth because it's associated with God's love. Oh, bears all things. Hallelujah. Bears all things. Believes all things. Hopes all things. Endures all things. Man, the love of God cannot be defeated. It is victorious every time. Love never what? Love never what? The love of God never fails. Again, love is a choice. Trust comes by true relationship with God. And in this love is maintained by refreshing. That love must be refreshed all the time. The love of God is refreshed all the time, which brings to remembrance again. It brings integrity. It brings an identity. It's a connection that's maintained all the time with God. You and I—that's our responsibility to maintain the connection and to maintain the refreshing. Because when you're not refreshed, you're refleshed. Romans 8. And there is no but in that language. Amen. But. And there's no justification. There's no excuses. There's no blaming anyone. You know, everything that comes on us, we bring on us. Amen? Because what you sow is what you reap. You sow peace, you reap peace. You provoke, you be provoked. Love does not compromise. It's pure. It fights. See, you must fight for God, maintaining God's love. So you're constantly moving back the powers of darkness, and the lusts of the world, and all the entanglements, the self, the man-pleasing, and stay refreshed in God's love. That means you must be refreshed all the time, things brought to remembrance. Look at what did the word tell us? Come out from among them and don't touch anything unclean. Even Eve knew that and tried to preach to the serpent. And then the serpent deceived her with what she preached to him. Romans 8:12. Let's speak it. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the what? Flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will what? Live. So you want to be refreshed, not refleshed. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are what? These are what? Sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to what? Why? Because fear brings bondage. But you received the spirit of what? Adoption, by whom we cry out, Abba, Father, which means daddy or papa. See, that's relationship. When you're no longer just, he's no longer just God, Savior, Lord, King. He's dad. He's papa. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then what? Heirs and heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be what? Revealed in us. So you're going to go through it. But remember, you going through it is to shed the old so the new comes. It's all a process of training for reigning till Christ's character has been perfected in you. We're to be refreshed, not refleshed. In other words, so that you don't react, you respond. And it can only be done by bringing things to remembrance. Things must be brought to remembrance. Hebrews 12. Hebrew. Hebrews 12 and verse 5. Everyone say correction.
Correction.
Brings direction.
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 Brings protection. Oh, snap. Correction brings what? Direction. And direction brings protection. So when God says no, what's the final result? Protection.
Amen.
Does everybody get it? Verse 5, and you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as to sons and daughters. My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord. That's correction, man. Nor be what? Discouraged when you are rebuked or grounded. By him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens, he corrects, he spanks. Because correction brings direction, and direction brings protection. That's what the counsel of the Lord is. It's amazing how many people make decisions without counsel.
Amen.
You know why? Because they know what the answer is going to be. Amen. Hallelujah. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens and scourges every son whom he what? Receives. For if you endure chastening or correction, God deals with you as what? Sons. So you're going to get rebuked. You're going to get scolded. You're going to get corrected. Like, what's the end result? Protection. So that you don't do what you feel like doing. Because you're being misled by the influence of fear. Does everybody get this? The I want syndrome. I want. That's the baby syndrome. That's what a baby says. I want. Me. Amen? That's a sign of immaturity. But we go from immaturity to maturing. There's a process. So you're going to finally get to a place. Your I wants will come down from 1,000 to 500 to 200 to 100 to occasional 4 or 5 or 3. Until finally it's you want. If you endure chastening, God deals with you as sons. For what son is there when a father does not chasten? But if you are without chastening, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate and not children of God. God will correct us. He will chasten us. You will get rebuked. You will get spanked. And he'll put restrictions on us. He sets up the boundaries and says, that's it. You've gone over this boundary long enough. I want to protect you and get back into these boundaries. Amen. Oh, yes. In verse 9. Furthermore, we've had human fathers who corrected us, and we paid them respect. Shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and what? And live. For they indeed for a few days chasten us as seemed best to them, but he for our profit, that we may be partakers of his what? Holiness. Now no chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. Nevertheless, afterward it yields a peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. So it's used to what? Train. Train. Why? So that you walk in an area of protection. And what are you being protected from? The enemy who seeks to what? Devour each and every one of us, to breach the love of God. So that the sound mind, power, and love of God is breached. That's what the enemy comes to steal. And he replaces God's love with lust. Lust. Oh, correction brings direction. Direction brings what? Protection. It is the judgment of God to his children. It is to protect us from evil traps, expose evil influence, and train us up to mature us so that we become partakers of the blessings as his children. So we learn to restrain ourselves from overstepping the boundaries of dishonor. We learn to train ourselves, because the Holy Spirit's training us, so that we don't overstep the boundaries of dishonor. Because when there's a step over the boundary, it is dishonor. In other words, there's no reverence to God. There's no fear. There's not only dishonor, there's disrespect. And the love of God, the fear of God, has been breached. Why? Because we've stepped into the enemy's realm. We stepped into the enemy's realm. Now, again, this needs to be understood. We, you know, the word says get wisdom and all things get what? Understanding. Now, let me explain to you about understanding. Understanding is three things. It is discernment, comprehension, and interpretation. It is discernment, comprehension and interpretation. Romans 12. Refresh or refresh. Romans 12. Verse 1. Let's speak it, please. Verse 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service or responsibility. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the what? Renewing, which means what? Refresh. Of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. See, without that refreshing, without that renewing, there is no refreshing, and you cannot prove the will of God. In other words, you will not be able to fulfill it. Renewed in the mind, refreshed by the presence, word of God, and fellowship to prove his will or to do his will. Why? Because we want to come against the influence of man and the kingdom of darkness. The only influence you want to be influenced by is the Holy Spirit. Amen? And he is truth. He guides us to all truth. He tells us what's to come. He is the Spirit of truth. So that we are not led by how we feel. Again, that seems to be the number one problem in the body of Christ. Too much soulless living. Amen. Too much. It brings chaos. Brings division. It brings people, the restraints go off. There's no restraints in the soulless arena. Do what thou feel like, as Satan's Bible. There's not enough living out of the Spirit. There's too much soulishness. And the reason for that is because there's not enough refreshing. Because there's not enough being renewed. 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 Why? Because the enemy comes to steal, kill, destroy. He's trying to steal everything. Believe me, by the end of the day today, he's going to try to steal everything that has been imparted in you here today. That's his job. It says he comes to steal the seed. Next thing you know, you're back off in the flesh again and forgot everything you just came from. 1 Samuel 16. Hallelujah. That's why we're to encourage one another. Put out fires. Don't put wood on a fire. Unless it's the fire of God. Then you put oil on that. 1 Samuel chapter 16. Verse 14. Now, King Saul was the first king. God anointed him. The Spirit of the Lord came upon him. But Saul became rebellious and obedient and prideful. And the Lord said, I'm done with you. As for being king for me, because you could no longer represent me. God still loved him. His love for him didn't change. But his trust in him did. So you can gain the trust of God and then lose it. Why? By not being consistent. Then by not being steadfast. By not being refreshed. And so the Lord anointed King David and said, look, I'm going to replace you, Saul, down the road. But in the meantime, I'm going to put someone near you to maintain your kingship. Because I'm removing the kingship anointing from you, which is a warrior. And I'm putting it on David. So David, the only way Saul could survive and maintain kingship at that period of time is to have David come and play the music so that the anointing of kingship could come upon Saul. Is everybody with me? Verse 14, it says, but the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul. So don't never think that the Spirit of the Lord cannot depart from you. The Word says God never forsakes us because he's always there. His love for me and you will never stop. But let me tell you, he'll lift his presence from you. Because his presence does associate with rebellion, disobedience, and evil. It exposes it. And if it's not exposed, he departs from it. But the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and what came? A distressing, tormenting spirit from the Lord. Him troubled came from the Lord. Why? God's created all things, hasn't he? And this tormenting, distressing spirit came upon King Saul because the anointing lifted from him. And verse 15, and Saul's servant said to him, surely a distressing spirit from God is troubling him. It was a demon. Let our master now command your servants who are before you to seek out a man who is a skillful player on the harp. And it shall be that he will play it with his hand when a distressing spirit from God is upon you. And you shall be what? You shall be what? Well. Go to verse 23. Let's speak it. So it was whenever what? The Spirit of God was upon Saul, that distressing spirit, tormenting spirit, that David would take a harp and play it with his hand. He was praising and worshiping the Lord. Well, he was backed by the anointing, wasn't he? That Saul would become what? Oh, snap. That he would become what? Refreshed. And what? Well. And the distressing spirit would what? Depart from him. So he became refreshed, he got healed, and got delivered. Does everybody got it? That distressing spirit, it was a spirit of fear. It was a spirit of what? Fear and torment because of Saul's rebellion and disobedience and not refreshing. He was refreshing. But refreshing came by David because of the presence. And the Word says that in the presence of God, there's fullness of what? Joy. And the joy of the Lord is our what? Strength. Is that refreshing? Yes. Yes. Acts 3. Acts chapter 3. In verse 19. Acts 3 and verse 19, please. What's the first word? Repent. What's it say? Repent. In other words, repent for your sins. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. Repent. Look, when you begin to agree with something, don't justify it. Repent. Lord, forgive me. Forgive me for being a bonehead. Forgive me for being ignorant. Forgive me for not refreshing myself. Forgive me for not trusting you. Forgive me for not abiding in you. Forgive me for not maintaining fellowship. Forgive me for not forgiving others. Forgive me. Why? Because you must be washed by the blood. It's cleansed by the blood. Then there's a refreshing that will come by the Spirit of God. He doesn't go, look at the blood always goes before the Spirit. Remember, sin will back the presence of God up. What you hear, what you watch, what you agree, what you touch. See, we already know when we're doing something that's not pleasing. We already know. We already know not only what to do, but we already know what not to do. We already know. But the mind, that spirit of fear And the carnal man will try to overcome you so that you are misled and not led. That's why he says only those that are led by the Spirit are sons of God. They have victory. Because to be a son, there's love, pure love. Is everybody okay? So he says, repent. Why? Therefore, and be what? Converted, that your sins may be blotted out, so that times of what? Refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send Jesus Christ, who was preached to you before, whom heaven must receive until the times of restoration of all things which God has spoken by the mouth of all of his holy prophets since the what? World began. See, so there should always be an area of repentance. In other words, you are looking to, for conviction from the Holy Spirit in everything that you do and every decision. You know what? There should be a conviction when you're not even singing the words of God. Don't turn your back on him. It's not time to pray. It's time to exalt him. That's why the words are up there. People go in to pray. Or people pick up their Bible and start reading it. And the last person who picked up a Bible and read it, I hit him with it. During worship. What's the matter for you? God doesn't interrupt himself. That's an area where we learn. God doesn't interrupt himself. When he calls time to worship, it means worship. You're sowing those words. Why? Because those words, you're eating. And while you're eating, you're being refreshed. Things are coming to remembrance. Those are God's promises up there. It's how great he is. It's how much he loves you. And you're telling how much you love him, not how much you feel about him. Oh, glory. Is everybody all right? Isaiah 28. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Why? Because in his presence is fullness of joy. Isaiah 28. Refresh or what? Reflesh, one or the other. Isaiah 28. In verse 9. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. Whom will he teach knowledge? And whom will he make to what? Understand the message. Now, what is understanding? What's the three things of understanding? Discernment, comprehension, and interpretation. So that we may discern, comprehend, and interpret the message. Those just weaned from milk, those just drawn from the breast, for precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little, there a little. In other words, the word always backs up itself. For with stammering lips and another tongue, he will speak to his people, in other words, through interpretation of tongues, through revelation of tongues, he will speak to you. That's speaking in tongues. And what's it going to bring? To whom he said, this is the what? Verse 12. The what? The rest with which he may cause the weary to rest. And this is the what? Refreshing. Yet they would what? They would not hear. They rejected it. That's, look at, praying in tongues refreshes you. So many people just, you know, that's stirring up the Holy Spirit, stirring up the gift. Well, one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit is tongues. It is a priority gift. That is the most priority gift for an individual. It's a self-exaltation gift. Praying in tongues stirs you up, man. You're praying God's perfect will. You're getting revelation imparted in you. You're getting refreshed, not refleshed. You're getting rest. And it's increasing your faith. Snap. 1 Corinthians 15. Praying in tongues also brings connection. It brings a connect. When a person's disconnected, first thing they start struggling with is praying in tongues. In fact, they fight to try to pray in tongues. It should just flow. That's when you're connected. Rivers of living water. 1 Corinthians 15. Refreshed, not refleshed. Verse 33. Do not be what? Do not be what? Why? Because what follows deception? Fear. Do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. Awake to righteousness and don't sin, for some do not have the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. That's what he says. Why you hang around with people? Why do you associate with people that are unevenly yoked with? Why do you go live with people that ain't work right with God? You don't go live with an unbeliever. I don't care if it's your mother. Does everybody get it? If they're not right with God, you don't go there. You're an idiot. And deceived. Why? Because that is going to affect you. Oh, I'm okay. You're prideful. Is everybody okay? This is reality. Do not associate with unbelievers. Oh, glory. Awake to righteousness and don't sin. And this, he says, I speak to your shame. Why? Evil, rebellious, non-followers of Christ bring reflesh, not refresh. You'll be living with all their accursed items and all their garbage in there. They'll be telling you all kinds of worldliness and trying. The devil will use those individuals to steal the seeds of God. That's a first arena. Wait a minute. What's understanding again? Discernment. What else? Comprehension. And what else? Interpretation. Well, obviously, if you're going to go be doing these things, do not be unleavened yoke. You've lost understanding. Amen? Oh, glory. 2 Peter 1. I know you got to work with some people that way, but that's why you shake the dust off. In fact, sometimes you just need to quit that job and trust God. If it's overtaken, you get the heck out of there. God's got another door. Because then what you're doing is serving money, not God. You're not trusting him, you're trusting you. Then you're not laboring under the Lord, you're laboring under yourself. Now you're being refreshed in No, you're being refleshed instead of being refreshed. It's a false refreshing. Hallelujah. You know, anyways. 2 Peter chapter 1, is everybody there? Verse 12. Let's speak it. For this reason, I will not be negligent to what? Remind you. Everybody getting reminded today? Always of these things, though you know and are established in the present truth, if you are. Yes, I think it is right, as long as I am in this tent, to what? Stir you up by reminding you, knowing that shortly I must put off my tent, just as our Lord Jesus Christ showed me. Moreover, I will be careful to ensure that you always have a reminder of these things after my decease. That's why we do teachings on video and tape. That's why I have Eternal Library, so we can always be reminded. This is to bring, in other words, remembrance, to bring things to remembrance. it helps to refresh yourself. That's why we fellowship. That's why we get counsel. That's why all of these things. Why? Because when we lack these things, then we don't trust. And when you don't, can you trust someone that don't trust you? No way. That's how God is. It doesn't mean he doesn't love you. But there's some people I ain't giving the keys of my car to. Or the bike. Or my house. But there are some people I will. Because they've earned trust. Isaiah 40. Isaiah 40. Verse 28. Have you not known? Have you not heard the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth? Neither what? Faints nor is what? Weary. His understanding is what? Unsearchable. He gives power to the weak, and to those who have no might, he increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, but the young men shall utterly fall. But those who what? Wait on the Lord. Those who seek, those who follow, those who chase the Lord shall be what? Renewed. So what's happening? He's saying that they will be refreshed. They will be renewed in their what? Strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles, and they shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not what? Faint. Why? Because they've been refreshed and not refleshed. Yes. Colossians 3. Verse 5. Let's speak it. Therefore what? Put to death. It's a good day to die. Anybody ever tell you you need to die? It means you need to deny yourself. Therefore, put to death your what? Your members which are on the earth. Fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desire, covetousness, which is idolatry. Because of these things, the what? Wrath of God is coming upon the sons of what? Disobedience. So can we fall into the sons and daughters of disobedience? Yes. In which you yourselves once walked when you lived in them. But now you yourselves are to what? Put off these things. And how are you going to put them off? By stirring yourself up in the Spirit and refreshing yourself by bringing things to remembrance of his presence through praise and worship, of his word through confession, and of fellowship. But now you yourselves are to put off these things, anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds and have put on the new man who is what? Renewed. Everyone say renewed. In other words, it's brought to remembrance. And what? The knowledge according to the image of him who created him. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew nor circumcised nor uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave nor free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on what? Tender mercy. Well, how are you going to put on tender mercies? By being what? Refreshed. Put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, you also must do. And above all these things, put on what? Love, which is the bond of perfection. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body. And be what? And be what? Now look at it. What does it say next? Let the word of Christ dwell in you what? Richly. With all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Why? Because you're being refreshed. He's telling us how to refresh. And he's also warning us those things that will be bring refresh. Amen? And you walk around like a grumbling, complaining, all kinds of goofiness, soulish, woe is me, oppressed, fearful, tormented, What if, and all the other stuff. By being refreshed. But you'll overcome that by being refreshed. Amen. And you know, sometimes you got to humble yourself and ask someone, man, pray with me. Pray with me. Don't get in an argument with someone. If someone's going to be grumbling and complaining, stick out your hand. Don't tell him he's got a devil. You can't counsel a fool. Amen. The fool's got to go. That spirit of fool's got to go. Amen? Man, you got a devil. Forget it. Let's pray. Let God expose it. Amen. Then if that person sense it, man, there's times I tell my wife, look in my eyes. Man, I sense something. I'm whatever. Pray with me. And then I'll pray. Look in here and cast out whatever you see. I'll go in the mirror. I'll look at stuff. If I see something in there, it's gone. So don't go look in the mirror with sunglasses. Yeah, I don't see nothing, man. I'm fine. Forget it. Full of pride. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians 4. Yeah, I looked in the mirror. I didn't see nothing. Of course you didn't. Flesh creature. Second Corinthians 4:16. Hallelujah. Yeah, man, the enemy will drain you. He loves to drain you. That's why you got to get refreshed. And when you get drained, you get refleshed. Somebody is, I mean, that people grow weary, they get refleshed and not refreshed. Verse 16, therefore, what? We do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being what? Renewed day by day. See, you got to be renewed every single day. You must be refreshed every single day. You start your morning by being refreshed, not being refleshed. For our light affliction, which is what? But for a moment is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we don't look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are what? Not seen. For the things which are seen are what? Temporary, but the things which are not seen are what? Eternal. Let me tell you, when you're refreshed, you can't see the eternal things. Amen. Only when you're refreshed can you see. Because it's like a washing and cleansing. Everything is clear, sensitive again. Day by day, every day, there must be a refresh, not a reflesh. Ephesians 4. Oh, glory. That's why you got to come against that spirit of fear and weariness. And you got to be a first striker. Why? Because you must disconnect from the world first so you can get reconnected. You can't get reconnected if you're not disconnected from the world. Amen? Ephesians 4 and verse 20. But you've not learned Christ, if indeed you have heard from him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning your former conduct the old man, which grows corrupt, according to the what? Deceitful lust, false love. That's the love of the world. And be what? Renewed. Bring to remembrance what? In the spirit of your mind so you can overcome. And that you put on the what? New man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, put in away lying. Let each of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. And don't be angry. Or it says, but you can be, don't be angry according to the flesh, be angry according to the spirit. It's called righteous anger because you hate sin. You hate evil. So there's an area where you can be angry, amen, but it's not anger according to torment or murder or hatred. It's an anger. It's love. It's God's love of anger. That's what brings chastening and correction, amen. Be angry and don't sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil, which brings a refresh and not a refresh. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give to him who has need. And let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth. Why? Because what you speak is what you eat. But what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. And do not what? Grieve the Holy Spirit of God. He will lift from you. He'll lift from us. And next thing that comes is a familiar spirit, and you still think you're doing God's will. Oh, I ain't got no conviction. Of course not. You're dull, hard-hearted, rebellious. You won't sense that conviction. You think everything's cool. But you really didn't hear from God. You really didn't hear. You heard from an emotion. Amen. You heard from a desire. You heard from the flesh, but you didn't hear from God. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all what? Bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. Whoa. You've not learned Christ, renewed in the mind, things that bring refresh and not reflesh. Amen. 1 John 2. 1 John chapter 2. Oh, glory. In verse 15. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Do not what? Do not what? Do not love the world. In other words, then that's lust, isn't it? Do not love the world or the things in the world, for if anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Why? Because it's lust. People are fighting for their will, fighting for their life. See, we're not to fight for our life no more. We're to fight for his life. I don't fight for my life. I fight for his life. Because when his life is in my life, I have life. Does everybody get that? Do I need to say that again? I got funny looks from some people. You fight for his life. His life is your life. Without his life, we don't have life. Then we're lovers of the world. Then we're fighting for our life. Amen? Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world or fights for the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Being deceived. For all that is in the world, the what? Lust of the flesh, see? Tells you that the love of the world is flesh, isn't it? The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is what? Of the world. And the world is passing away in the lust of it, but he who does the will of God abides what? Forever. So, can you do the will of God if you're being refleshed? No, only by refresh. And I'm going to close at 2 Timothy 2. 2 Timothy 2 and verse 20. 2 Timothy 2 and verse 20. Everybody there? For in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, some for honor and some for dishonor. Which one do you want to be? Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter, meaning the old man, the world, the old ways, he will be a vessel of honor. Wow. How many of you want to be a vessel of honor? As being a vessel of honor, there's an honorable death. You leave a legacy. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter, he will be a vessel of honor, sanctified and useful for the master, prepared for every good work. Flee also youthful lusts. That means things of your past. But pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace with those who call on the Lord out of a what? Pure heart. Associations bring impartations. But avoid what? Foolish and ignorant disputes, knowing that they generate strife. And a servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach, patient, which means endure. In what? Humility, humbleness, correcting those who are in opposition. Look, you can't correct if you ain't correct. That's very good. You can't correct unless you're correct. That's correct. Correcting those who are in opposition, if God perhaps will grant them what? Repentance. God grants repentance. See, you must seek repentance and ask to be granted to you. That's why we seek conviction. Because when you're looking for conviction, you're actually looking to get repentance granted. But if you're not looking for conviction, you're not looking to repent. And you're not looking to keep yourself cleansed. And you're not going to be refreshed, you're going to be refleshed. That God may grant them repentance so that they may what? Know the truth, and the truth sets you free, right? Practicing the truth. A lot of people know the truth, but they don't practice it. Amen. That they may come to their what? Senses. These are spiritual senses. And escape the snare of the devil, having been taken captive by him to do his will. This is what this is about. Look at the next verse. But know this, that in the last days perilous times will come, for men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure, rather than lovers of God. We're there right now. That's what's going on in the world. Having a form of godliness, but denying his power. And from such people do what? Turn away. Don't associate with them. For this sort are those who creep into households and make captives of gullible women and men, loaded down with sins, led away by various lusts. Many people get taken out by the opposite sex easily because they're soulishites. Because they're not being refreshed, they're being refleshed. They can't make that decision. They need a companion so badly and forgot that he's the greatest companion. Amen? Hallelujah. Now, let's go to the next one. Verse 8. Now, as Jannes and Jabez resisted Moses, so these also resist the what? Truth. Men of corrupt minds disapprove concerning the faith. But they will progress no further, for their folly will be manifested to all, as there's also was. Always learning and never able come to the knowledge of the truth. Because see, they're learning, but they're not refreshing. So you can get all this kind of knowledge, but not refresh yourself in the presence of God. So people use knowledge to justify and twist the knowledge to their means. People can quote scriptures any way they want. But there's one true interpretation by the Spirit of God. Remember, being refreshed is being renewed. And being renewed what? So that your identity and the divine nature of Christ is established in you. So that we make decisions according to his will, not our will. So we come out of the soulish arena and live in the spirit. So we don't make emotional decisions, but decisions by truth. So that we can progress and not digress. Amen? Listen, if God be for us, who can be against us? But we are in a time and season right now where many are being misled so easily. Nobody's made it. Never let your accomplishments dictate your decisions. Never. Or your failures to dictate your decisions. You allow the truth to dictate your decisions, and that's it. Amen? Amen. Praise God. Father, we are honored and blessed. We thank you for your mercies, your grace, for your refreshing, for your truth, for your chastening, for your counsel, correction, and direction, that we may have protection. Let it be so imparted in us and protected by the blood today. Let the seeds that are imparted grow and bear fruit for your glory, that they may take root and never be pulled out. In Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.